Good morning. After having covered the spectrum of ocular surface tumors, let's go over to the management. Well, there are some benign tumors that we need to take care of. Choristomas, this is a dermal lipoma, which is in the supratemporal. We don't have a pointer on the mouse, is it? Okay, anyway, that's all right. So that's a supratemporal dermal lipoma. In such a situation, when there is a benign tumor, when you want to excise it for, say, functional reasons or cosmesis, then you should take care of the fact that you should not cause any complication, functional issues. There are two structures that are involved in a dermal lipoma. One is the lacrimal gland, the palpebral lobe, which can be prolapsed, which may be even infiltrated with dermal lipoma. The second is the lateral rectus that is somewhere there. So the way to excise dermal lipoma is quite simple. In fact, that's a video. Can you play on that? Right, you always decide which is the advancing edge of the lesion and make the conjunctival incision. The tumor is typically anterior to tenons. So you have to get into the plane between the conjunctiva and the tenons. You should never go episcleral. Right. So what I'm using is a radio frequency electrode. So this part of the conjunctiva is adherent to the lesion and that gets dissected along with the lesion. Rest of the dissection is purely subconjunctival, anterior to the tenon. So you never get to even see the lateral rectus. And the conjunctival incision is always ahead of the palpebral lobe of the lacrimal gland. Then you have to simply get into the space between the conjunctiva and the tenons and excise it off. As it gets to the lateral fornix, you find that it is truncating, it is becoming narrow, right? And then it gets into the orbit. So that narrow portion has to be excised off. That pink thing is the conjunctiva that was completely adherent to the lesion. Then how do you repair it? You can use glue, tissue glue, and an amniotic membrane for a cosmetically gratifying outcome. So that is how you excise a dermal lipoma, and similar technique can be used for excision of any benign tumor where the goal is not to cause any functional problem and yet give the cosmesis that the patient wants. Right. When you have a malignant tumor, the philosophy totally changes. In a malignant tumor, what comes into picture is not just the fact that you have to take the tumor away, you also have to ensure that the tumor doesn't spread to the regional lymph node and also doesn't cause systemic metastasis. So life is at stake when you deal with malignant tumors, especially melanomas. Ocular surface squamous neoplasias can also get into the regional lymph nodes and have systemic metastasis, but melanoma has a very high risk of having systemic metastasis. But when you look at the literature, what is shocking is that there is about 20 to 30% rate of local tumor recurrence. So what does that mean? That we are not doing a good job, right? Obviously, you have to have less than 2% local tumor recurrence, and if you're having 20 to 30%, that's really not good job. And as the tumor recurs, the more is the frequency of tumor recurrence, more is the chance that the tumor may get into the regional lymph node or get into the orbit, thus causing problems. So when you do surgery, it's not that the surgical technique only matters. Surgical technique is of course important, and any self-respecting phaco cataract surgeon can do a good job with conjunctival tumors, I'm sure of that. But what is very important is combining your surgical skills, which is excellent already, with some of the oncological principles. That will give you the best result. And when you talk about oncological principles, you talk about two things. One is margin control, and the second is base control. Margin is the periphery of the tumor, base is its vertical extension. If you clear tumor from both the margin and the base, then the chance of local tumor recurrence would be reduced substantially. You may actually end up getting less than 2% of local tumor recurrence. So before we embarked on a protocol-based management, we looked at our own results in our own institute, where we had a large number of cases which were operated by multiple surgeons. Some of the early surgeries were done by cornea specialists and later by ocular oncology service. And we found that there are certain risk factors which foretell local tumor recurrence. Invasion of the tumor, I mean vertical, diffuse tumor, the larger the tumor, which is very difficult to delineate in terms of its horizontal extent. So what becomes important is the use of Rose Bengal staining, which Vikas was mentioning, to use to delineate the margin of the tumor. failure to perform edge cryotherapy, which is a very simple 2-minute measure. If you don't do that, you might leave some subclinical microscopic tumor behind, not having dealt with positive resection margins or base. So histopathology comes into picture here. Unless you know clinical risk factors and also build in histopathological risk factors, you'll never be able to treat the patient completely. So what is really important is to orient your pathologist, ophthalmic pathologist, to give out the risk factors in his histopathology report and then use it for the benefit of the patient. Finally, systemic cancer predisposition. If a patient is young and has multifocal, say, ocular surface squamous neoplasia, you have to actually go ahead and investigate why does he have it. There might be systemic cancer predisposition. Any young individual who comes with OSSN has to be looked for HIV seropositivity or immunocompromised status. Any patient who comes with OSSN with multifocal lesions, you have to ask for the history of organ transplantation and post-organ transplantation immunosuppression, or chronic use of steroids, or for that matter, HPV infection. So since there are systemic risk factors which can predispose to local tumor recurrence, and that needs to be looked at. And again, what is important is to update yourself and combine oncological principles with recent advances. So I'm going to deal with what are the tools that we currently use in the management of conjunctival malignant tumors. We use Rose Bengal staining and do a good slit lamp evaluation and delineate the tumor entirely. This is a picture that we would take to the operation theater. This is a large A4 sheet drawing of conjunctiva, not retina. Obviously, you know, we're not used to drawing conjunctiva so big, but it is very important that we draw in a difficult situation. This is a difficult situation. This is by my teacher, Dr. Shields, had drawn this diagram to show me how to draw a conjunctival diagram, and I still preserve it. It's a very beautiful diagram that she has drawn, and I try to copy her. And all the tumors, every part of local tumor recurrence has been marked here. This was a recurrent case that she got as a referral. And she has also marked the area that needs to be excised. So this is hung in front of the microscope. You keep looking at it and then excise it. You keep doing the same over a period of time. You learn to excise it completely. Rose Bengal stain is very important in delineating the extent of the tumor. Sometimes slit lamp is not enough. No, not just the tumor that you see here, but beyond the tumor, you can see that there is stippling of Rose Bengal. All that area was subclinical. Now with Rose Bengal, subclinical part of the tumor becomes evident, and beyond that you have to go 4 millimeter. So Rose Bengal staining will tell you the horizontal extent of the lesion. That will give you better chance of having margin clearance. Now let's go talk about the base. How do we know base clearance? Base clearance is something which is very difficult to know by slit lamp evaluation. You have indirect measures, like you transpalpably move the lesion on the epibulbar surface. If it moves, you guess that it is not adherent to sclera, right? That is one way of knowing if there is episcleral adhesion or not. And the most certain way of knowing is by using anterior segment imaging. Tools such as this, anterior segment OCT, now can show the base of the lesion very effectively. But the only problem is that when you use ASOCT, if there is keratin within the lesion, then there will be shadowing, and base localization may become difficult. This is a beautiful picture where you see that only the conjunctiva is involved here and the sclera is all spared. So dissection now is very clear. The plane of dissection will only be conjunctiva and never to take the tenons along. This was also being shown earlier, that anterior segment imaging will tell you if there is intraocular extension already or full thickness scleral extension already. In which situation you won't simply plan excision, you have to plan adjuvant therapy as well, such as plaque brachytherapy or even enucleation. So anterior segment imaging tools have come in a very big way in the management of ocular surface tumors. They will tell you about the depth of the lesion so that you can plan your surgery much better. This is one nice example where you see that there is full thickness corneal invasion, and there is no way of guessing that this patient would have full thickness corneal invasion unless we had done imaging for this patient. Clinically, we cannot ever predict that this patient has corneal invasion, so we'll need a penetrating keratoplasty for this patient. After having excised the tumor, there will be a gaping hole in the cornea. Right. So now let's go on to topical chemotherapy and topical immunotherapy. These are the drugs that are available for topical treatment of ocular surface squamous neoplasia. Let me talk about ocular surface squamous neoplasia first, because that is the most common conjunctival malignancy in India, followed by melanoma, and the treatment principles are almost the same in terms of surgical management, although chemotherapy obviously is not applicable for melanoma. Mitomycin, 5-fluorouracil, sidofluvir, and interferon. What are the indications? Indications are several, but before that, let's see how do they compare with each other. Cost is not a major concern in India because all these three drugs cost nearly the same per month. This is the per month of cost that I have mentioned. The dose is mentioned here. I don't want to repeat what is mentioned already. But what are important are the side effects. With mitomycin, patients are not very comfortable. They tolerate. Indians are known to tolerate things quite a bit. So they tolerate pain, they tolerate discomfort, they tolerate photophobia. They think that the drop is working if they have all these symptoms. But actually, they're not comfortable. They have red eye, they have chronic conjunctivitis. When you shift them over to interferon, they realize the difference. Oh, this particular medicine is so beautiful. So interferon is very well tolerated, whereas mitomycin has tolerability issues. It is not very friendly to the ocular surface, but is extremely effective, and 5-FU comes somewhere in between. Refrigeration is also important. In situations where refrigeration is not possible, then you cannot possibly use mitomycin C so regularly. Interferon alpha 2b is the most recent addition to the armamentarium that we have for topical treatment. It is not called chemotherapy, it's called immunotherapy because that is the basis how it works. There are three ways in which it works. Immunotherapy, where it gives you complete tumor control. Immunoreduction, when you reduce the tumor to a smaller size so that you can do minimal surgery. Immunomodulation, when you modulate the ocular surface with long-term use of topical interferon in patients who have a high risk of local tumor recurrence, such as xeroderma pigmentosum or HIV seropositive patients. So this is a three types of use of topical interferon. This mouse is not working. Slide is not going ahead. Okay. This is a patient. You see that there is corneal ocular surface squamous neoplasia. Can you see that this is the area there where my cornea specialist had done a biopsy, right? So what are possible here? Surgical excision or topical treatment? It's not moving ahead, please. Can you do? Okay, so what we did here was topical chemotherapy with mitomycin. And finally, after the patient has completely regressed, this is 3 years following complete regression, you see that there is a subtle corneal scar in the area where biopsy had been performed. So it's easy to guess that if this tumor were to be completely excised surgically, we might have left subtle corneal scar in the pupillary area, thus precluding 20/20 N6 vision. But now, having used mitomycin, the tumor is completely gone off, and in the area where biopsy had not been performed, cornea is extremely nice and clear. So that is the beauty of topical immunotherapy or chemotherapy. There is scarless healing. There's hardly any chance of corneal opacity if the tumor has not gone beyond the epithelium or the Bowman's membrane, beyond to the stroma. And of course, in infiltrative lesions, anyway, you cannot use topical chemotherapy. I have a problem. There is no mouse is not working. But I have to advance the slide, right? This is one more example where topical chemotherapy has been used. You can see that the tumor is quite extensive. It is extending along the limbus for about 7 to 8 clock hours. So the first indication, corneal involvement. Second is more than 6 clock hours of limbal invasion. Why is that? Because if you excise a tumor which is very extensive around the limbus, then you will be damaging the limbal stem cells, and there is a possibility of acquired limbal stem cell deficiency and further conjunctivalization of the peripheral cornea. That is the reason why chemotherapy is advocated for patients who have tumor which involves more than 6 clock hours of the limbus. Surgery is obviously an option, second option to chemotherapy, but when you do surgery for extensive lesion, you can combine simple limbal epithelial transplantation along with your surgical technique so that the chance of limbal stem cell deficiency is much less, not working again. This shows you this is a small lesion. Obviously, it's such small lesion you can do surgery, but it's such, in such a small lesion you can do topical chemotherapy and get rid of the lesion for scarless healing, not working. This is an example of a patient where there is a large diffuse lesion. This is one more clinical indication. When the lesion is so large and diffuse, of course you can excise it, but you have to do a large amniotic membrane transplantation. There may be scarring, but with topical interferon, the tumor is completely gone and there is no scar left. This is how topical interferon helps you in managing these patients. Not working. This is an example of immunoreduction. Immunoreduction is a principle when the tumor is very large and you want to limit your surgery. This is the extent of the tumor, and following chemotherapy, you see that only that part of the tumor is left behind for surgical excision. It works on this principle. When there is ocular surface squamous neoplasia, the epicenter is generally the limbus, and the most severe portion is in the epicenter. And the most severe portion is the infiltrative squamous cell carcinoma. It is surrounded by a zone of carcinoma in situ, severe, moderate, and mild dysplasia in that order. What topical drugs do is they resolve dysplasia and carcinoma in situ, and they leave behind the zone of infiltrative squamous cell carcinoma or invasive squamous cell carcinoma. Topical chemotherapy does not work on invasive squamous cell carcinoma. It works typically on carcinoma in situ and dysplasia. So what is left behind is the component that will not go away with topical chemotherapy, and that needs to be excised. Rest of it is anyway already gone. So the extent of surgery that you now do will be limited only to this area. This part of the cornea is all scarred, and this is a viable tumor. So chemoreduction or immunoreduction is a principle where you reduce the size of the tumor. Now, if you have a very extensive disease like this patient has extensive squamous cell carcinoma involving the entire ocular surface. We have done a MAP biopsy to confirm that. And unfortunately, his other eye is thysical because of a prior agricultural injury. 5 years ago, we would excentrate such patients. We no longer excentrate them. We actually treat them with high-dose injection of interferon in the periocular area, around the lesion subconjunctivally. As many injections as you want, generally up to 6 injections. Next slide. This patient resolved with 3 million international unit interferon injections, just 3 injections followed by topical interferon, and a repeat MAP biopsy showed that there was no residual tumor, and 3 years later, he is still doing well without any local tumor recurrence. So extensive lesions like this, where both the bulbar surface and the palpable surface are involved, are again indications for injection interferon along with topical interferon. Next slide. These are non-malignant tumors. This is a patient with conjunctival papilloma from Mongolia. He had multifocal recurrences. He even had a nasal extension through the nasolacrimal duct. And we obviously excised it, whatever that could be excised, and rest of the lesion was managed with injection of interferon. And he never recurred. So this was a patient where there was recurrence 4 times earlier. We used interferon as adjuvant treatment to minimize the chance of recurrence. Next slide. This is a child with multiple recurrences of papilloma. These are all papillomas. So second indication for interferon is not just OSSN but also papillomas. Now after excision with injection interferon, papilloma has never come back. Next slide. Well, this is how you kind of split out the advantages and disadvantages. Topical chemotherapy is non-invasive. It reduces the incidence of limbal stem cell deficiency. It provides scarless healing. If the surgeon doesn't have microsurgical skills and you still want to treat OSSN, it is not a limitation now because you can use topical chemotherapy. But the disadvantages is that it is expensive. You have to give topical chemotherapy for an extended period or 9 months or a year. It costs much more than what a one-time surgery would do. Patient obviously has to be committed to long-term treatment and follow-up. Follow-up is very essential. You cannot just give these drops and forget. Patient has to come back for follow-up every 3 weeks, and you have to renew your medications. Compliance issues, if the patient doesn't use even anti-glaucoma medications fully knowing that he will go blind, how do you trust the patient to use all these medications? They generally are non-compliant. So if there is a compliance issue, then these patients are best prescribed surgery. Finally, no histopathology evidence. That means that you are not doing biopsy in these patients. These are clinical diagnosis. Since you don't do biopsy, there is always a chance, a very outside chance, that the patient may have something else than what you are actually thinking. Next slide. So what are the situations when you don't use topical interferon? When the diagnosis itself is in doubt. Next slide. Like this patient who has unilateral blepharoconjunctivitis. Next slide. When you look at the ocular surface, it does look like ocular surface squamous neoplasia, but actually the patient has sebaceous gland carcinoma. You see the thickening of the lid margin, loss of meibomian gland orifices, rounding of the posterior lid margin. This is pagetoid sebaceous gland carcinoma where chemotherapy will not work. So if the diagnosis is in doubt, if you think that it is something that is mimicking OSSN but not really so, then you will want to do biopsy and confirm. Next slide. This looks like OSSN, but it is not OSSN. This is an amelanotic melanoma. So obviously, this patient has a shiny surface. When the lesion shines like this, doesn't have a dull, buffed surface, generally it is not OSSN. If at all it is OSSN, then it is the mucoepidermoid variant of OSSN. So you should consider that, okay, this may not be OSSN. Let me do biopsy and confirm. And if you are actually doing biopsy, you might completely excise it as well. Next slide. So when diagnosis is in doubt, go for surgery. Next slide. When you are unsure about the depth of the lesion, when anterior segment OCT or UBM will not tell you the depth of the lesion or the severity of the lesion, please don't go for topical chemotherapy, go for surgery. Surgery is more definitive if the tumor is deeper and invasive. Next slide. Patients like this, which I already showed, are not candidates for topical therapy at all. So when you are unsure about the depth, use imaging, and if you are still not sure, go for surgery. When you are unsure about the stage of the disease, next slide. This is actually AJCC classification has been misinterpreted. This is a nice publication, but what they have said that they have achieved a certain amount of success in case of OSSN with topical interferon. Next slide. But what AJCC talks about, next slide, is in histopathology. You know, AJCC is not just clinical, it also talks about histopathology. When it talks about infiltration, it assumes that, AJCC classification assumes that biopsy has been done and the invasiveness of the tumor has been detected. It is not clinically determinable how invasive the tumor is. So when you round up AJCC into very simplistic kind of assumptions and use this to report your results, everybody gets into the impression that, okay, interferon works like magic. It doesn't work like magic in invasive tumor, and that is what we need to realize. So if you are very sure about the fact that the patient has a very superficial non-invasive lesion, then it is good to use topical interferon. But when you're not sure, then definitely surgery is the option. Next slide. Patients like this, you know, this patient was started on topical interferon. Obviously, his tumor is invasive, and what has happened is that the tumor has progressed despite topical interferon. This patient will never benefit from topical interferon, and this patient is a good candidate for surgery and radiation. Next slide. So when you are unsure about the stage of the disease, go for surgery. Next slide. When you are unsure about the patient motivation, compliance, and socioeconomic situations, go for surgery. This is a very good indication for local tumor excision. A small tumor, elevated tumor, 3 or 4 millimeter in depth, maybe invasive. Patient has a cataract, he is almost blind. He never wants to come back for follow-up. Good case for local tumor excision. Don't try interferon in these patients. Next slide. Is scarless healing with interferon a myth? Not really. You can see that even with interferon, you can have corneal scar. So scarless healing is not always possible with interferon. And scarless healing is possible even with surgery. This patient has about 8 clock hours of limbal involvement, but following surgery, there is no conjunctivalization or limbal stem cell deficiency. So if you have a patient where you cannot use topical chemotherapy or interferon for some reason, you can definitely go for surgical intervention. When adjuvant chemotherapy is guided by guess and not by histopathology, don't use topical chemotherapy. Next slide. You have to have histopathological evidence that will tell you what adjuvant chemotherapy should be given following surgical excision. Next slide. this is what I would use. This is our protocol. If the resection edge is positive with only dysplasia or carcinoma in situ, if you're already done edge cryotherapy, then only observe the patient, don't do anything else. If you're not confident that you haven't taken care of the residual lesion by edge cryotherapy, then do topical chemotherapy or immunotherapy. That is, if the resection edge is involved only with dysplasia or carcinoma in situ. If the resection edge is positive with invasive squamous cell carcinoma, then you have no other option but to re-excise, at least for medico-legal purposes. If your report says that the tumor is left, there is no way you can treat with topical chemotherapy if it is invasive squamous cell carcinoma, because literature is very clear that invasive squamous cell carcinoma cannot be treated with topical chemotherapy. If the resection base is positive and if it's only 1 clock hour, then you can go back there and do cryotherapy, a heavy cryotherapy, if it's only 1 clock hour. If it's more than that diffuse, then you have to do plaque brachytherapy. Then adjuvant immunotherapy is used in patients who have multiple recurrences and syndromic variants. Next slide. So adjuvant treatment should always be guided by histopathology and not by guess. Next slide. So now we have two clear situations: topical treatment and surgical treatment, and somewhere in between is the gray zone, and that calls for clinical acumen. So when you tread this area of gray zone, then you have to be really very careful as to, you know, what kind of experience do you have in treating these patients and how they may do based on your experience. All that comes into the equation, and then only you'll be able to treat. Next slide. When it comes to surgery, the principles are very clear. Surgical excision with 4 millimeter clinically clear margins after having stained the tumor with rose Bengal. Corneal component is generally removed with alcohol-assisted keratoepitheliectomy. Lamellar keratectomy and lamellar sclerectomy are not performed unless the corneal stroma is involved and the sclera is involved. Lamellar dissection has to be performed, taking tectonic integrity of the eyeball into consideration. Cryotherapy to the resection edge is always performed. Cryotherapy to resection base is performed up to 3 clock hours if you have any suspicion that the base is involved. Next slide. This is how I would do surgery. The tumor has already been demarcated using rose Bengal. Beyond that, I am using 4 millimeter clear margins. Using a RF bipolar electrode, I have marked my surgical margins. Then I use a unipolar electrode to excise it. You can definitely use scissors. The tumor is never touched, and what you hold is the edge of the lesion. Lift it up, and under visualization, you dissect. Everything has to be done under visualization. Cauterize the episcleral blood vessels so that your final excision is bloodless. Apply alcohol to the leading edge of the lesion. This is absolute alcohol. After having dried the cornea, you apply right to the apex of the lesion and 4 millimeter beyond. Scroll off the corneal epithelium towards the limbus. So you are excising about 3 to 4 millimeter of corneal epithelium beyond the involved edge of the tumor, but gently with alcohol, not to disturb Bowman's membrane, which is the barrier for tumor progression posteriorly. Bowman's should never be disturbed. You've reached the limbus from the corneal side. We have already reached the limbus from the conjunctival side. And we know that OSSN is a tumor of the limbal stem cells. The next step is very superficial limbectomy. You can use BSS or Ringer lactate to make sure that the blood doesn't obscure your view and gently excise the lesion off the limbus. And that's how you do double freeze-thaw cryotherapy, where you hold the cryoprobe or drape a 3 millimeter cryoprobe around the conjunctival edge and freeze it, and your endpoint is visible. You don't do a reverse cryotherapy, not from top to bottom, because then you don't know whether the edge has been completely cryoed or not. This is a good way of doing edge cryotherapy. Lift the conjunctiva, drape the conjunctiva over the edge of the cryoprobe, 3 millimeter cryoprobe, go twice around. This patient did have some, what I suspected, deeper invasion into the limbus, so we are doing base cryotherapy, and this can be performed up to about 3 clock hours without much complication. Nothing will happen to the cornea if you do base cryotherapy. And how do you repair? You can use a conjunctival autograft, you can use a sliding flap. I typically use amniotic membrane, with Tisil glue so that the patient is very comfortable following surgery. There are no sutures to remove, and the graft remains in place, and amniotic membrane provides for scarless healing and also ensures that there is minimal amount of limbal stem cell deficiency. Next slide. Next. Next. All right. Next slide. These are some of the results of surgical excision pre and post. Hardly any scar if you use amniotic membrane. Next slide. This is a patient who had presented with bacterial keratitis along with OSSN, and the area where there was bacterial keratitis has a scar, and that's been removed with amniotic membrane. Next slide. One more example of smaller OSSN with surgical excision and direct closure of the conjunctiva. Next slide. Next slide. This was a patient who had a larger limbal invasion about 7 to 8 clock hours following excision with amniotic membrane transplantation. Much larger nodular tumor following excision with amniotic membrane transplantation. Next slide. And a patient who had scleral invasion, larger nodular tumor with scleral invasion with lamellar sclerectomy. We didn't have to repair the sclera because sclera tectonically was good. About 80% of depth of sclera was left, and the base was negative, so no adjuvant treatment was required, and that's how the patient did postoperatively. Next slide. And if the base is involved, then you do plaque brachytherapy, either as a primary if the tumor is shallow, or secondary or adjuvant plaque brachytherapy if the base comes positive on histopathology. Next slide. This is a patient where there is obvious scleral invasion. Earlier, we would do extended enucleation for these patients. Next slide. Now we do lamellar sclerectomy, excise the tumor, and treat the scleral base with plaque brachytherapy. This really works wonders. You can see that all these patients have scleral invasion. Following plaque brachytherapy, they have avascular but tectonically strong scarred sclera, and the tumor has completely gone away. Next slide. One more similar lesion, plaque brachytherapy. Next one. And this is a melanoma with scleral invasion. That's the area where there was scleral invasion. That is the nodular component, which was easy to excise. And following plaque brachytherapy, the patient is doing well after 3 years. And this is a newer variation of plaque, which looks like a simblefron ring, where both the sides of the plaque are coated with ruthenium emulsion, which can simultaneously treat both the bulbar surface as well as the palpable surface because both the sides are coated with ruthenium. So this is a very nice way of treating the entire ocular surface at one go using plaque brachytherapy. Next slide. Sentinel node biopsy has already been talked about. Next slide. Some of the destructive surgeries that we used to do in case of OSSN, where there is intraocular extension and orbital extension as well, we would do orbital excentration. Next slide. And whenever we do it, we preserve the flap of skin and suture the upper lid to the lower lid skin flap so that the patient has a concave ocular surface, concave socket surface on which we can fit a excentration prosthesis. Some of the newer advances are medical treatment for orbital squamous cell carcinoma, orbital extension. Patients where surgery is not possible, very elderly patients. This has been published. This is from a published report where after using elotinib, you can see that the lesion has become stable and has not changed its size for about 2 years of follow-up. So this is a new development in the management of squamous cell carcinoma where medical treatment is possible for orbital extensions where you cannot do orbital excentration because of the age of the patient or for other medical reasons. Next slide. Briefly about lymphoma. Lymphoma is now become a medically treatable disease. This was a patient who had extensive conjunctival lymphoma where all we did was a very small biopsy, confirmed the diagnosis, and the patient was treated with a safe protocol of bendamustine and rituximab. And you can see nice ocular surface following completion of treatment. Next slide. So in conclusion, I would say that a combined surgical approach along with combination of that with oncological principles provides impressive success in the management of malignant ocular surface tumors, and you have to take advantage of current advances in anterior segment imaging, topical chemotherapy and immunotherapy, and also brachytherapy to optimize the results. Thank you so much. I think we have 10 minutes to complete the course. If you have any questions, anybody has any other case to share or discuss, yeah.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It was a nice presentation.
Thank you.
I just wanted to inquire, is there any role of AC tap to study the carcinogen in OSSN?
No, AC tap actually we don't do, and you don't have any advantage unless there is intraocular extension of the tumor. Then you can do AC tap and study the cells, but it is not advocated. Whenever there is intraocular extension, anterior segment imaging helps. And when you do slit lamp evaluation, you see large anterior chamber cells. The cells are much larger than in uveitis. They are pearly white cells. There is a large keratic precipitate. That's what you see. So there is no role, I believe. Yeah.
Sir, I wanted to ask one.
What we use is 3 millimeter probes. Temperature, Upper Sami doesn't have a temperature couple, but we have a Keeler probe which has a temperature couple, thermocouple. Both can be used. Endpoint is freeze anyway, so you really don't have to bother about the surface temperature.
So I had a patient, an elderly patient who came with a large OSSN. On histopathology, there was focal invasion of the base.
Right.
So I advised plaque brachytherapy to the patient. Patient disappeared after that, was lost to follow up. Came back 8 or 9 months later. There was still no recurrence of the tumor.
Right.
Now would you advise brachytherapy or just observation?
No, if the patient hasn't recurred, you can observe. You know, there. It is not that every patient who has a base positivity will have local tumor recurrence. Nothing is absolute in medicine. But you go by the risk. The risk, known risk according to literature, is that if the patient has full thickness invasion of the base, then if it's more than 1 clock hour, then you have to take care of it, and the only way you can take care of it is by doing plaque brachytherapy. But if you don't do it, is not that all patients will recur. Some patients are lucky not to recur. Some patients' histopath might have been misinterpreted by the pathologist because of the drying artifact. When the tissue dries before it is processed, what happens? It shrinks. So, you know, alcohol can also play a role in shrinking of the tissue, and you know how the pathologist has cut the specimen, how the technician has laid the specimen out. There are many factors which play a role, so it's not absolute that every patient has to recur. So simply leave alone.
Thank you, sir.
Speakers are not allowed to ask questions.
I have a question, and probably this is kind of a question that I have, which most of us would be, you know, when you get a referral case. Not that every institute and college has a good pathologist that as you have, who would, you know, comment on the margins and the base. So at times you get, like, you know, patients referred to you with a pathology slip just telling that invasive squamous cell carcinoma.
Right.
You have no idea about the base, you have no idea about the margin. How would you go about it?
Well, if the pathology report is suboptimal, you have to call for the slides and blocks and have it read. Pathology is the key to manage recurrences. If you don't have pathology, then you have to start all over again as if you're treating a de novo case. And when you send the specimen for histopathology, I forgot to mention in my lecture, you have to lay it flat on a filter paper, draw the ocular surface, lay it flat on a filter paper, and let the tumor dry and get affixed to the filter paper, then you put it in formalin. So it has to go as you have dissected and as you have excised. The edges should not shrivel in or roll. You cannot put it in a bottle and send it to the pathologist and expect him to interpret. The margins all have to be very clearly marked when you send such a sample. If the margins are not marked, then the pathologist will be all at sea. He will not be able to interpret it. And you always, if you have a high volume OSSN, it's a good idea to talk to the pathologist, explain to him what you're doing, and explain to him or her what you expect from the pathologist, or have him or her speak to an ophthalmic pathologist or who is already experienced in handling OSSN. So when they exchange ideas, they become much better in dealing with conjunctival tumors. This is little different than treating, say, eyelid tumor or orbital tumor, where histopathology is more straightforward. Here, since the edge and base are very crucial in terms of tumor excision and achieving tumor control, this had to be interpreted very carefully. Next slide. Any?
So I have 3 questions. First is, sometimes I get cases of CIN and dysplasias, which I excised with margin positive, but cryo not done.
Right.
So in that those cases, we were giving mitomycin for 4 cycles. So some patients, they don't tolerate. So if I have to go to interferon, then what is the protocol for adjuvant therapy in this case?
Interferon adjuvant therapy is given for 3 months, 4 times a day, continuous without any break for 3 months. For mitomycin, rule of 4, 0.4 milligram per ml,
yes.
4 times a day, 4 days a week for 4 weeks, that's 1 cycle. Then give a gap of 2 weeks and repeat it 3 times.
3 times.
Yeah.
And then in OSSN, like you said, for focal therapies, you can go back. And for focal invasion, you can go back and do the cryo. But if the cryo was already done during the surgery, and do you still advise to go back? And no need. And then in the papilloma cases in young children, after excision, you advise to give again injections of interferon?
In papilloma? Papilloma, you give interferon injection only in two situations. First is you don't want to do surgery, it's too extensive. Second is that the patient has already recurred. You know, in primary cases, when you surgically excise, you don't want to use adjuvant therapy. Papilloma is a benign lesion, so why do you want to overtreat the patient? Only if it's recurred or when you don't want to do surgery, those are the indications for interferon.
Yes, thanks.
Mm-hmm. If you want to start interferon, how long we can
keep? Right. If a patient has xeroderma pigmentosum, if it's a localized lesion, you can surgically excise. If it's diffuse lesion, if it's bilateral, I would prefer topical interferon as the primary treatment. And after waiting for tumor to completely go away, you would still continue topical interferon in once a day dose indefinitely, forever. That assumes the, you know, there is a principle called immunomodulation of the ocular surface, and based on that, if you treat the patient on once a day dose of topical interferon, there's a very high chance that the tumor may never recur. I have a bunch of patients of xeroderma pigmentosum who have been on topical interferon, and their frequency of local tumor recurrence has really come down. Otherwise, they would come every 3 or 4 months with a new tumor. Now, for years together, they are stable and they haven't come back with a new tumor. Continuously on topical interferon, once a day dose. Yeah. Right.
We have plaque with us, mm-hmm. where we apply for. So, depending upon the thickness of intraocular extension, earlier we used to enucleate these cases.
Right.
We can consider...
Absolutely. Intraocular extension, limited intraocular extension up to 6 millimeter is an indication of for plaque. Beyond 6 millimeter, ruthenium is not effective. If you have iodine, you can go up to 8 millimeter.
Can it be done as like a primary plaque brachytherapy, or still you would excise and then place...
Problem in doing primary plaque brachytherapy in a patient with intraocular extension is that the depth is difficult to treat. So you excise up to the sclera, and what is inside the eye, you do plaque brachytherapy. This is primary plaque brachytherapy. Whenever I have done that, I have excised the tumor and applied plaque right on the table, not waiting for 6 weeks, as we generally do, not for the ocular surface to heal. You treat it right on the table after excision. The second reason why you want to do surgery first and then do plaque is that the surface of the tumor is uneven. So plaque will not sit comfortably. Plaque is made to conform to the curvature of the eyeball and doesn't conform to the curvature of the tumor or this rough surface of the tumor. So you kind of go and create that normal curvature of the eyeball by excising everything up to the level of sclera and then nicely place a plaque on top.
Thank you.
Sir, one more question. You showed one patient with a corneal invasion, about 70-80% corneal invasion was there.
Right.
And then you said this patient would need a lamellar keratoplasty. You plan a lamellar keratoplasty on table.
Full
thickness keratoplasty.
Right.
Okay. Now, how about, you know, excising it in a lamellar fashion and then giving plaque instead of going in for a primary keratoplasty? Because on table, what I feel is, even if there are some microscopic cells, then there are chances of those cells going inside the AC. And instead of creating that situation, we just remove 60-70% of the cornea and then probably do a plaque.
Right. I didn't want to say it because I have a bad experience in plaquing cornea. I had a corneal melt after having plaqued the cornea. Right. So I have never done it again because there was a total corneal melt after having plaqued the cornea. I'd seen others doing it. It's not been reported plaquing cornea, but everybody tells you that cornea can tolerate a good amount of radiation. But in a compromised situation, I doubt whether it will really tolerate radiation. Compromised situation because you have done surgery on cornea. Cornea is prone to melt. It's an avascular tissue. On top of that, we do radiation. So there is a chance that cornea may melt. And that patient had to be salvaged with a therapeutic penetrating keratoplasty. There was a huge melt. So after that, I have never done this again because when I talk to my colleagues elsewhere, they also don't have experience in plaquing the cornea. I don't want to do something new and then get into trouble because corneal melt can be very bad. Thank you then.